This video is brought to you by Surfshark. Geothermal energy has the potential to be an always-on power source for countries around the world. However, it hasn't been the hottest renewable energy option because drilling deep enough into the earth to reach sufficiently high temperatures is difficult and costly. Yet a startup has recently unearthed a solution that might solve this problem, a heat ray to melt rocks. Well, sort of. Now, I know it sounds like a Star Wars remake, but we're not talking about the Death Star here. This is actually a well-established nuclear fusion technology being reapplied to geothermal energy. Could it unlock the true potential of geothermal energy and make it better than solar and wind? Let's see if we can come to a decision on this. And spoiler, it's pretty cool. Or should I say hot? I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. I'm currently in the process of building a new net zero home, and I'm scoping out getting a geothermal heating and cooling system installed for it. The idea of tapping into the earth as a stable heat source for a heat pump system is really enticing for homes. But we can also tap deeper into the earth for a consistent super hot heat source to power turbines to generate electricity for our cities and towns. Unlike solar and wind, geothermal energy could provide a more stable supply of clean power while taking up barely any land. On the other hand, current drilling techniques can't affordably reach the hottest spots of the earth to unlock that potential. In fact, penetrating deep into the hard rock is tricky and expensive. Along with exploration, digging wells accounts for about 40% of the total upfront cost of a geothermal plant. That's why scientists are turning to a death ray. Again, not really. I'll get to this killer technology in a minute, but first let's have a brief recap of geothermal energy. This source of power has been on our planet forever. Well, actually inside of it. The Earth's inner core is about as hot as the sun, which is why it's often nicknamed the sun beneath our feet. Good news is that it will take billions of years for the Earth to cool down. Fueled by residual heat from our planet's creation and the decay of radioactive elements, this underground sun gave rise to the natural hydrothermal reservoirs. Basically, the Earth's nucleus heat pushes water up through the permeable rocks until it hits a wall, also known as impermeable cap rock. Now trapped, the water pressure rises and can sometimes break through. Think of Roman baths relying on hot springs, or perhaps Icelanders toasting bread over geysers. Aside from enabling carbon-free hot baths and outdoor barbecues, we can use subsurface hot steam to drive a turbine and produce electricity. And to do that, you have different plant configurations. Out of all the options, binary cycle power plants are the newest and most sustainable ones. Unlike other designs, binary plants don't use the underground hot water to generate steam directly. To be more specific, after extracting it and further heating it up to about 400 degrees Fahrenheit or 204 degrees Celsius, they run it through a heat exchanger. Here, the geothermal water transfers its heat to a secondary liquid with a much lower boiling point. This then generates the steam that will spin the turbine. The plant includes a condenser to convert the steam back into a liquid and reuse it. Leveraging this closed-loop binary system, the water won't boil off the geothermal fluids, which, other than water vapor, contain carbon dioxide, hydrogen sulfide, and other toxic compounds. You can probably see why this is a greener and preferred alternative to dry and flash steam plants. The overall geothermal potential is huge. According to UltraRock Energy, harvesting only 0.1% of the planet's heat could satisfy the world's energy hunger for 2 million years. Now, given how cool that is, or hot, why did geothermal energy account for only 0.55% of our global electricity generation as of 2018? Mainly because the accessible part of that is heat scattered across the Earth's crust. In fact, most hydrothermal reservoirs, such as volcanoes, springs, and geysers, are only found along tectonic plates. In addition, the water filling shallow geothermal pockets isn't hot enough to make energy harvesting cost-effective. Not to mention the technical and economic hurdles of reaching hotter spots using current drilling techniques. Yet, thanks to fusion-inspired drilling technology, the true potential of geothermal power could be closer than ever. This innovation could get us below 10 kilometers or about 6 miles in a much more cost-effective fashion. Down there, geothermal sources have much higher temperatures and are more widespread. While being cost-effective, the potential of solar and wind farms is undermined by their intermittency. Instead, a 24/7 green energy source like geothermal could give us an extra powerful weapon against global warming. And speaking of weapons, let's dig in deeper into how death rays, again, not a death ray, could push geothermal energy to a new level. Before I get to that, I'd like to thank today's sponsor, Surfshark. I always recommend using a VPN when using public Wi-Fi, but VPNs can be extra powerful even when you're at home. A lot of online services use some pretty sophisticated commercial tracking and machine learning to apply very targeted advertising. A VPN can protect you from some of that. Now, Surfshark's clean web does a great job blocking ads, trackers, and malicious websites, making it safer to use the internet even at home. And you can even make it look like your IP address is coming from a completely different country. This can come in handy if you want to stream a video that's only available from a specific location. And one of the best parts of Surfshark is that it's easy to set up on all of your devices, whether that's iPhone or Android, Mac or PC. Surfshark is the only VPN to offer one account with an unlimited number of devices. Use my code to get 83% off plus 3 extra months for free. And Surfshark is also giving away their antivirus for free during this month in June. Now, Surfshark offers a 30-day money-back guarantee, so there's no risk to try it out for yourself. Link in the description below, and thanks to Surfshark and to all of you for supporting the channel. Now back to the fusion tech that could push geothermal energy to a new level. It all began with the work of Paul Waskoff, a senior research engineer at MIT's Plasma Science and Fusion Center. In 2012, he demonstrated the application of a gyrotron to vaporize rock instead of grinding it. This high-powered vacuum tube generates a beam of millimeter-long radio frequency waves, which have been used to heat up plasma and control its temperature in fusion reactors for the last 50 years. Hijacking this fusion tech, Waskoff envisioned drilling ultra-deep geothermal boreholes. So how does it actually work? You would have a metallic tube embedding the gyrotron, blasting high-frequency electromagnetic waves to fuse the underground rock. The system injects a gas for cleaning up the post-vaporization mess. To be more specific, the gas cools down the hot vapors, which condense into nanoparticles. These are then flushed out of the well by the high-pressure stream, but you wouldn't use this sophisticated drilling for the entire process. I reached out to Quasar's CEO, Carlos Araque, for the on-the-ground, or perhaps underground, arm of this geothermal revolution, who filled me in on that.
So in geology, you have the sedimentary rock, and then below it, you have the basement. Sedimentary rock, it's unconsolidated. It's easy to drill through, and it's what mechanical drilling systems are very good at doing. So you drill that first portion conventionally. No difference there. But the second portion is very, very hard to do. So that second portion, we use these ideas from millimeter wave drilling. We basically put in the hole, we put a pipe, a metallic pipe. It looks like oil and gas pipe. And inside that pipe, we put the beam and we put the gas, and that's it.
Based on his experimental results, Waskoff figured out that millimetric waves make the drilling process more cost efficient. First, you wouldn't be limited by temperature and rock hardness. On top of that, there is no need to have downhole mechanical equipment that could get damaged. And thanks to a wavelength about 1,000 times longer than that of a typical infrared laser, the millimetric waves sputtered by the gyrotron go through incoming rock nanoparticles without experiencing significant scattering, which means the beam doesn't lose much energy before reaching the target surface. Also, the hot molten rock takes up way more energy when irradiated by a gyrotron compared to when hit by a standard laser. Overall, gyrotrons are up to 5 times more energy efficient than the best lower wavelength laser that you can get. But what about costs? Paul Waskoff had some thoughts on that too.
I did look at the cost of electricity to vaporize a volume of rock. That's the main consumable in directed energy drilling. And I made estimates that for an 8-inch diameter hole and about 10 kilometers deep, it would cost something like $500,000 of electricity to order vaporize an equivalent volume of granite of that size and depth. When you look at those depths, the total cost of a mechanical drill well is somewhere in the order of $30 million.
That's kind of crazy, right? If that proves out, we're talking about saving tens of millions of dollars. But there's another key economic benefit when using heat rays. When relying on mechanical processes such as rotary technology, you need a high-density fluid, which is called a drilling mud, to counter the surrounding pressure of the well, to prevent it from collapsing in on itself. In contrast, millimetric waves don't require drilling mud, but how would a gyrotron-drilled hole bear thousands of atmospheres worth of pressure without failing? When coming out of the gyrotron, some of the waves will hit the hole walls, which creates a glassy coating. Apart from sealing any wall cracks, the heating process will increase the internal pressure, which balances the outer force. As a result, it will be possible to burrow deeper yet more stable boreholes without adding any drilling mud, which is another aspect that could make the whole process more profitable.
You're making a glass-lined hole, and that glass is very strong. And so in effect, we are casing at the same time that we're drilling the hole, which is another big expense savings for making a hole.
When factoring in all those extra costs, Waskoff's brainchild turns out to be way more cost-effective.
So I estimate that the could be maybe 10 times cheaper than a similarly deep mechanical drill wall.
Aside from being costly, drilling mud doesn't work at temperatures like 500 degrees Celsius or 932 degrees Fahrenheit, which is where geothermal energy's production is most efficient. Paul had some really nice insights on that.
Drilling muds don't function at those temperatures very well. The weight of the column begins to run out and the deeper you go, because the density of the mud is never close enough to the rock density. So eventually you can't have enough drilling mud column to balance the pressure. However, with directed energy drilling at high temperature, we are always overpressured no matter what depth.
To be more specific, this mud-free drilling system could profitably withstand pressure-related stresses below 10 kilometers, which is where geothermal access becomes universal. According to the U.S. Department of Energy's GeoVision report, leveraging these untapped subterranean heat sources could increase geothermal-based electricity 26-fold by 2050. In addition to a wider availability, when you go below 10 kilometers, or about the 6-mile mark, you'll find the so-called superhot rock, or SHR. Those geothermal resources have temperatures about 375 degrees Celsius or 707 degrees Fahrenheit. Now, under these conditions, a geothermal plant can tap into supercritical water, which is more energy dense than non-supercritical counterparts. A well plunged into an SHR could yield up to 10 times more energy than a conventional enhanced geothermal system. Now, based on the technological and economic feasibility studies conducted by UltraRock Energy on the Newberry volcano site, SHR would reduce geothermal's levelized cost of electricity, or LCOE, by 50%. On top of that, the company estimated that SHR-based geothermal could have a lower LCOE than onshore wind and even solar. Now, clearly, Wafskopf's design holds promise for bringing our geothermal power supply to a higher level, or lower one, I guess, which means our energy grid would become much less reliant on fossil fuels. His fusion-inspired drilling tech is not just confined to the lab space. Last February, an MIT spinoff, Quaise, raised $40 million to develop this groundbreaking tech. They graduated from using a 10-kilowatt gyrotron to drill a 10-centimeter deep hole in palm-sized stone to using Oak Ridge Labs' megawatt-sized gyrotron. The company bore 3-foot deep holes into much larger rocks. Quaise is partnering with UltraRock to create their first pilot project, where they're aiming to drill a 3,300-foot deep hole near the Newberry volcano, which was chosen as an ideal testing site. In fact, UltraRock believes this crater could be one of the largest unused geothermal resources in North America. The presence of a shallow magma body makes the rock down there much hotter than other places, which is why UltraRock could reach superhot temperatures above 400 degrees Celsius or 750 degrees Fahrenheit, at a quarter of the depth you need to dig down in other places. So it's a good testing ground. Now, looking ahead, Quaise is planning to build its first full-scale hybrid drilling rig in 2024. Based on this setup, Quaise would first use a conventional rotary drilling to go down to the basement rock, which is where they would activate their gyrotron-powered rock vaporizing system to reach 20 kilometers or about 12 miles to reach temperatures as high as 500 degrees Celsius or 932 degrees Fahrenheit. The company touts that they could get down to that depth in 100 days using a 1-megawatt gyrotron. And just to give you a sense of scale, the Kola Super Deep borehole, the deepest hole ever dug on Earth, went down to 40,230 feet, or about 12.2 kilometers, and took 20 years to complete. Now, I can hear you already. Is 100 days even possible? Carlos, shed some light on this.
When you're 5 kilometers down, in a 10-day window, you may spend 30 hours drilling. That's the life of the drill bit before it needs replacement. 10 days is 240 hours, so 30 hours, an eighth of the time drilling, and the other 7/8 of the time running the pipe in and out of the hole to replace that drill bit. 10 days is $1 million of rig time. So we don't talk about drilling 100 meters per hour. We talk about drilling a very consistent 5-meter-per-hour rig. It just goes, because there's nothing to replace it. If we can hit drilling cost of $1,000 per meter regardless of depth, your LCOEs are in the 1 to 3 cents per kilowatt hour. So cost parity with wind and solar, but firm and always on.
So in theory, it sounds like Quaise has got some chances to achieve their goal. In practice, we should wait for the real-world tests in the field. And nevertheless, the company has a clear and clever long-term vision. They aim to retrofit existing fossil fuel plants, which will eventually be decommissioned during the low-carbon transition. Making the most out of the ready-to-use infrastructure, they could simply swap a coal or natural gas-generated steam plant with round-the-clock underground hot vapor to spin the turbines.
The steam can come from the ground. So that idea gets a lot of traction with power project developers because they have these power plants that they're losing their social license to operate and they're increasingly less in the money. So there's very few alternatives for these power plants to continue to operate. So those are the people that are most interested in what we're trying to propose and trying a pilot with them.
A pilot plant sounds exciting, but looks like it'll still take some time for it to pick up steam.
We're still more than 3-4 years away because we still need to do the technology demonstration before we even get to them.
Along their geothermal drilling path, quays may encounter some other issues. The deeper you dig, the more energy that you lose. As it stands, making up for this power loss means stealing electricity from the grid or running diesel generators. On the other hand, Quay's CEO claims that the fossil fuels consumed by their drilling system would be less than 1% of the renewable energy generated by the well over its lifetime. But their system needs to account for their gas pressure losses too. That's because of the friction between the gas and the pipe walls. The further down the gas travels, the higher its pressure drop, the bigger the pump you would need to circulate it in and out of the well. That's one of the reasons why Quay's estimated 20 kilometers may be the lowest depth that they can get. Another drawback of ultra-deep digging might be earthquakes. Creating wells could destabilize geological layers, which could trigger seismic activity. This has cooled down some geothermal enthusiasts in different countries after power plants were forced to close. Carlos had a different take on this.
When you drill for geothermal today, you're mostly drilling near tectonic boundaries because that's where the heat is closest to the surface. So you're very intentionally drilling near problematic zones with very young geology and very unstable geology. When you have the luxury to go deeper without an exponential increase in cost, you move away from those instabilities. I would even argue that maybe 95% of the business case for our drilling is away from tectonic boundaries. We're actually trying to make geothermal available no matter where you are. And most of the world is actually not on a tectonic boundary.
Earthquakes aside, Quays will need to keep an eye on the budget. As reported by the International Renewable Energy Agency, in 2019, setting up a geothermal plant would cost nearly $4,000 per kilowatt, which is roughly four times more than what you would need to spend for installing a solar farm. However, as mentioned by Carlos and Paul earlier, gyrotron-powered drilling could save money compared to a mechanical process. Now, I don't know if Quays' geothermal approach is the panacea for our energy transition, but it should definitely be thrown into the mix. Relying on multiple clean energy sources is a sustainable way forward. Now, Carlos's view seems to align with mine on this.
When I think of renewables, they're trying to do more with much, much more. So I don't think that's sustainable. And I think everybody forgets that, right? I'm not saying we shouldn't do renewables. I think we should. But we should not forget that things like these and things like fusion, they need work because they are the ones that can actually get us to where we need to be as a species.
I'm really excited by the potential of this. It's also really cool to see a technology from fusion research getting reapplied in such a unique way. The development of fusion-inspired drilling would let us tap into plenty of superhot fluids by overcoming geographical and geological limitations. It could also unleash a perpetual spring of geothermal power for a zero-carbon energy-independent world. However, although heat rays are based on solid tech, there are still economic barriers and testing to go through before reaching an industrial scale. So are you still undecided? Do you think this could make geothermal energy the future of our energy grid? Jump in the comments and let me know. If you like this video, be sure to check out one of the ones over here. And thanks to all my patrons for your continued support. And thanks to all of you for watching. I'll see you in the next one.